morning. Welcome to the worship of the God we know as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit here at Jacksonville Presbyterian Church. If you would, please join me in our call to worship. All who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, for we did not receive a spirit of slavery, but we have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Please join in singing, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies.
Spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee. And crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Oh, beautiful for pilgrim feet, whose stern impassioned stress are thoroughfare for freedom beat across the
America, America, God mend thine every flaw. Confirm thy soul in self-control, thy liberty in law.
Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberty. Strive, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life.
America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness, and every gain divine.
All beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears.
America, America, God shed his grace on thee, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Amen.
And now, as is fitting, for those who fall short, let us confess our sin in silent prayer to God. Let us pray. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Turn us from evil and teach us to do good. Point us down the path of justice. Empower us to rescue those who are oppressed. Though our sins are like scarlet, though they are red like crimson, wash us whiter than snow. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a reading from the Psalms this morning. This is Psalm 98, a psalm. O sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gotten him victory. The Lord has made known his victory. He has revealed his vindication in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord. For he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. And we've got the same reading from Acts that we had last week. I'm sticking with Pentecost Sunday for a couple of weeks here. So we're going to read Acts 2nd chapter, first 13 verses again. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.'" And from the letters, a reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. It's out of the 8th chapter, Paul's great chapter on the Spirit. Romans 8, beginning with verse 18. "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience." Okay.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. shall praise thy name in earth, in sky and sea.
Word for the young folks this morning. The Bible tells us in many places that creatures can talk to God. So the psalmist tells us that the oceans and the hills can praise God. And Paul tells us that the whole creation is groaning under the weight of human sin. So, I've got a task for you this week. I want you to pay attention to the non-human creatures around you. Creatures of God. So trees, and some of you have pets, your pets, horses, chickens, dogs, cats, look at the streams you go by outside. What I want you to do this week is to listen to see if you can hear the creation and the creatures of God praising God. Okay? Can you do that? And I also want you, after you do it, after you take time to listen, I want you to praise God. To just say to God, you don't have to say it to anybody else, "Thank you, God, for creating me. Praise be to you." Something like that. Okay? Very good. Let us pray. Our God, we thank you that you have created us and all things. Help us to listen, to hear the praise of the creation for you, and help us to join our voices to that praise. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Tomorrow is Memorial Day, a day for remembering those who died in fighting this country's wars. Do Native Americans count in that remembrance? Now, certainly the Native Americans who died fighting for this nation in World War II count. The best known were the Code Talkers. The Code Talkers were Native Americans, mostly Navajo, who were used to encode military communications in the Pacific theater of the war. Navajo is a complex language and, of course, very different from both English and Japanese. The Navajo language was used as a basis for codes by the U.S. military. Pairs of Navajos who spoke both English and Navajo were assigned to military units. One member of the pair would be at headquarters, where commands and orders originated. The other out in the field with an active unit. Orders were sent out in Navajo-based code and decoded back into English on the other end. Other Native American languages and their speakers were also used to encode messages during the war, all very successfully. Some of those Native American code talkers died serving. We remember them on Memorial Day. There is, of course, considerable irony here with the U.S. military benefiting from Native American languages the government and military, with the help of the church, tried to extinguish. We talked about that last Sunday. In the Second World War, we Americans benefited from the fact that we were unable to completely eliminate Native American speakers and their languages. What I want to argue today is that there is a peacetime benefit available to us as Christians from Native American languages. Last week, we considered the same Pentecost passage from Acts that we have before us this morning. Luke tells us that in the Spirit, the disciples proclaim God's mighty deeds. In other words, they spoke about the life, death, and resurrection of Christ Jesus. They proclaimed the gospel. And interestingly, the gospel was heard by each of the listeners in their own native tongue. The Spirit is making a point. The gospel is meant to be heard in the native language of every people on this earth. And so Christian scholars have been hard at work ever since, translating the Bible into every language on this earth. It's a lot of work. There are very many human languages. I want to suggest this morning that there is a maybe not so obvious benefit to the translation of the Bible into many languages. And that is this: the language you speak and in which you think impacts the way you understand the world and shapes the culture within which you live. Therefore, people who speak different languages bring different ways of thinking and of doing to the gospel, and that impacts how they hear the gospel and how they live it out. Different languages and cultures can enrich our understanding of the gospel and how it is to be lived out. We talked last Sunday about the attempt by the U.S. government and the churches to try and stamp out Native American languages and culture. The church was being disobedient to the Holy Spirit of Pentecost, the Spirit clearly indicating that the story of Jesus was to be translated into all languages, and so into each of the many Native American tongues. The American church instead tried to destroy Native languages and culture and to force Native Americans to learn in English about an American Jesus. As a result, to this day, many Native Americans reject the gospel. It is a grievous loss. It's actually remarkable that there are any Native American Christians, but there are some. Many and much was lost by the disobedience of the church. One of the losses was the different nuances Native Americans would have added to our understanding of the story the Bible tells. Native languages and cultures are very different from English and American culture. They would have added nuance to our understanding of the Bible. And I'm going to give you an example. The Earth Care Group is reading a book by a Native American author and professor of botany, Robin Kimmerer. The book is Braiding Sweetgrass. She compares the language her native ancestors spoke, Potawatomi, to English. She points out how the two languages provide us with different eyeglasses for seeing the world. There are, by the way, only 9 individuals left who speak Potawatomi fluently. The government and the church almost succeeded in eliminating them. Almost. Comparing English to Potawatomi, Kimmerer writes this: English is a noun-based language, somehow appropriate to a culture obsessed with things. Is our culture obsessed with things? I think she has that right. And she points out that in English-speaking American culture, not only do we have a focus on things, but we consider phenomena like oceans, hills, and mountains to be things without agency, things without the ability to express themselves. In Potawatomi-speaking Native culture, oceans, hills, and mountains are spoken of as animate, imbued with spirit. In English, we have people and we have things. People are subjects. Oceans, hills, and mountains are objects. In Potawatomi, people, oceans, hills, and mountains are all subjects. All are imbued with spirit and can express themselves. If your native tongue is English and your culture is American, you look at the world differently than if you speak Potawatomi and look at the world through Native American cultural eyes. The psalmist writes, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody." When the psalmist writes, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth," does the psalmist actually expect the earth to make a joyful noise to the Lord? Or is that just poetic license? And really, the psalmist expects only human beings to make a joyful noise to the Lord. The psalmist continues, "Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth." The psalmist is insistent. People sing for joy to the Lord, but so do oceans, floods, and hills. The psalmist portrays all of created reality as responsive to and responding to God. This wrinkles the brow of American English speakers like me, but makes perfect sense to Native American Potawatomi speakers and also Hebrew poets. I'm an English-speaking American with a scientific background. As such, my inclination is to look at oceans, hills, and mountains as things, inanimate objects that cannot communicate. If I was a Native American thinker, I would look at seas, hills, and mountains differently. And as a Native thinker, I would not be perplexed at all by Hebrew poets giving agency to those creatures and so describing them as praising God. Actually, don't the Native Americans and the Hebrews have it right? Don't oceans, hills, and mountains speak to you? Aren't you drawn to ocean, hill, and mountain? Don't they call to you? They call to me, not in human language, but in the language of ocean, hill, and mountain. And why not? Isn't God their creator? Doesn't God have a relationship with each of them? Why wouldn't God have given them agency and voice to respond to God and so also to speak to us? Native Americans say they speak. Hebrew poets say they speak. And by the way, so does the Apostle Paul. He writes in Romans, "We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now." Can you hear the groaning of creation, the groaning of ocean, hill, and mountain? Can you hear? Are you listening? Listening is a much neglected skill. How good are you at listening? To your neighbors? To those who look at the world differently than you do? To the earth and its creatures? How good are you at listening to God? Don't you have some work to do? Rather than listening to Native Americans, the English-speaking American church sinned grievously against them. What do we do when, as Christians, we are caught in sin? We repent. So maybe when the Earth Care Group reads Robin Kimmerer's book about seeing through Native American eyes and hearing through Native language, maybe if we listen and look in the way she suggests, that is part of the repentance that the church needs to do. Let us pray. Our God, we thank you for the many different cultures of this world. We pray that as the gospel comes to them, they would respond joyously in their own way to the gospel, and that together all cultures of this earth might be able to offer you praise along with the earth and its creatures as well. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you would, please join in singing, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hand."
He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the tiny little baby in his hands. He's got the tiny little baby in his hands. He's got the tiny little baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
And now let us say what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us come before our God in prayer. Let us pray. Our God, we thank you that the gospel has come to us in English so that we could understand it. And we thank you that we have responded to your gospel and that we praise your name in English. But we know there are many other cultures in this world. They need to hear the gospel in their own languages and to praise you in their own languages. Help us to support those who translate the scriptures. And our God, help us also to recognize that all the creatures of the earth have been given the ability to sing your praise and actually also to groan at our sinful behavior. Our God, help us to hear all of creation, whether singing praise or groaning, and help us to add our voice both in praise and in groaning. Our God, help us to listen. Help us to listen to our neighbors. Help us to listen to those from other cultures, to those with whom we disagree. Help us, our God, to listen, especially to you. And our God, we now lift up before you this morning those we know need your care, as we each indeed need your care. We lift up to you Marissa, Georgia, Linda and Janice, Nick, Jim, Holly, Jill, Bernie and Jackie, Sandra, Loretta, Michael, Norman, the Horn family, Frank, Mary, Jane, Tina, Susan, John, Phyllis, Jack, Joe, Barbara, John, Greg, Barbara, Bob and Gina, Nancy and Sandy, Ann, Kathy, Mary, Jesse, Betty Jean, Sarah and Leon. Our God, we lift up for your care Celeste Bursey, Tom and Nancy Dixon, Phyllis Kelty, Charlie Swiernick, Austin Kinney, Shirley Bama, Christian Hannigan. God, give us ears that listen to you, to others, to the earth. And let us join with the earth and its creatures in lifting up praise to you. And now we pray to you in the words that our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The only announcement I have for you this morning is if any of you would still like to continue to contribute to our Villages in Partnership fundraising campaign, please feel free to do that. Again, write out the checks to Jacksonville Presbyterian Church and put Villages in Partnership in the memo line. Could you do that? I appreciate it. And I want to thank all of you who have contributed, both to the Villages in Partnership fundraiser, but also who contribute to the church in any way. We thank you for your prayers, your time, your money, all that you give to keep the church going. We appreciate it. And now let me send you on your way with a benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you this day and forever. Amen. Go in the grace and the peace of God.